to discuss. In the simple vertical drop fall or Sarda fall consists of a vertical drop which allows the upstream water to fall with sudden impact on the downstream. So this is how, as we already discussed, a drop or fall would be provided to have the continuous alignment in line with the natural ground there, natural ground. So that is the reason why along the length we provide several falls, canal falls or canal drops. The downstream acts like a cushion for the upstream water and dissipate the extra energy. This type of a fall was first introduced on the Sarda canal system in UP and it is called Sarda fall. This is a vertical drop here with a rectangular crest for discharges less than 14 cubic meters per second. So this is how a Sarda type of fall, the sudden drop from water level here to water level here. The various elements in Sarda type fall are crest wall, then that is the body wall, rear wall, cistern, which may be provided in the downstream portion, impervious floor, and protection works on the upstream side and downstream side. So you have a crest wall, cistern, and impervious floor, followed by the protection works. So in this figure, you see it's another type of a fall where you have a crest wall. So this is the body wall or crest wall. This is the crest level. Okay. And upstream total energy level. And H is the head over the crest, head over the crest, head over the sill. So this is the body wall or crest wall. And the downstream portion, this is a cistern provided. By providing this cistern, when the water is directly falling, when the water is directly falling onto the downstream portion, it absorbs and it dissipates the energy, dissipates the energy. However, you need to provide a good impervious horizontal floor on the downstream portion. So this is all the impervious floor. So this is the impervious floor, third one. This is the impervious floor, cistern, then impervious floor. Further, you need to provide the protection works, maybe a protection work here in the form of a cutoff is provided. Say, this is the downstream vertical cutoff. Similarly, in the upstream side also, you need to keep a protection work. Why do we require protection works? The protection work is not provided when the water is flowing there. After this impervious floor, once again, there will be scouring of the bed. Scouring of the bed, that is the reason why a protection work should be provided. Thereby, the exit gradient, the hydraulic pressure would be well within the limits, well within the limits of protection. But once again, shown here, like this is the body wall, cistern, then protection works. This is the impervious floor, followed by the protection works, which are provided in terms of block pitching, brickworks, pitching, and so on. The design criteria for various elements of this Sarda type of wall are as follows. Crest wall. The crest wall may be designed either for free flow condition or for submerged flow condition. It should be designed for both the conditions. The discharge equations adapted for rectangular and trapezoidal crests are given here. For a rectangular crest wear with free flow, the discharge Q is given to be 1.835 into L into H to the power 3 by 2 into H by B to the power 1 by 6, where Q is the discharge in meter cube per second, L is the length of the crest, and H is the height of water above the crest, that is head over the sill, and B is the top width of the crest. So if you know the values of H, B, and L, so the discharge Q would be equal to 1.835 L H to the power 3 by 2 into H by B, whole to the power 1 by 6. For a trapezoidal wear, it would be like Q is equal to 1.99 into L H to the power 3 by 2 into H by B, whole to the power 1 by 6. So these two are for the free flow. For the drowned condition, submerged condition, of both the types of wears, let it be rectangular or let it be trapezoidal, the neglecting the velocity of approach with a coefficient of discharge CD for the free and drowned positions, the discharge Q would be equal to CD into L into root 2G into 2 by 3 into HL to the power 3 by 2 plus HD into HL to the power 3 by 2. HL is the drop in the water surface. HD is the height of water surface on the downstream side above the crest of the weir in meters. Then we have seen now about the discharge equations. Next is, what is the width of the crest wall? So for a rectangular crest wall, the top width B will be equal to 0.55 root D, and the bottom width B1 would be equal to H plus D by root S. H plus D by root S. S is the specific gravity of the material. We know wherever it is a rectangular crest wall, the top width and bottom width must be same. But however, at the bottom, only at the bottom without giving any inclined upstream or downstream slopes for the verticals, for the vertical faces also at the bottom, the width would be increased for the crest wall. Increased for the crest wall, and hence b1 is h plus d by root s. For a trapezoidal crest wall, b will be equal to 0.55 square root of h plus d, and the upstream face is about 1:3, downstream is 1:8. So to arrive at the crest level, upstream FSL minus h for the free overfall condition. If the height of the crest wall above upstream bed is h, then upstream full supply depth will be d1, and a small h will be equal to d1 minus h. For a drowned condition, h will be d1 minus HL plus H, because for the submerged condition, you need to take the loss of it also. Cisterns will be provided. Length of the cistern will be 5 times EHL to the power 2 by 3. And for the impervious floor, the total length of the impervious floor may be taken based on the Bliss or Cosmas theory. And the minimum length that is required to be provided is 2 into D1 plus 1.2 into HL. This is how the impervious floor is to be provided. Length of the impervious floor is to be provided. You have seen here the length of the impervious floor which is required to be provided. This is what I was trying to tell you. This is a rectangular Sarda type of weir where the top width is B and the bottom width is B1. Though it is only rectangular, it is not trapezoidal with the slopes, but still the bottom width is increased to B1. In ideal cases, top width would be equal to the bottom width, and then what you have to do? Bottom width will be more critical, and as you need to increase, you need to provide same B1 even at this portion also. So huge material will be wasted. So to economize, you have the top width different from the bottom width. Okay. So the downstream floor should be made thick enough to resist the uplift pressures. The minimum thickness should be limited to about 45 centimeters on the concrete and 35 centimeters for the brick masonry. A sufficient depth of cutoff below the floor should be provided. Usually, the depth of cutoff would be D1/3. D1 is upstream full supply depth, and minimum cutoff at the downstream portion will be D2/2, where D2 is downstream full supply depth. What is cutoff? It is the length of the pile which is required to be provided at the upstream side as well as in the downstream side. Good energy dissipation arrangement also is to be provided by providing like baffle walls, and then chute blocks are to be provided here. So for large discharges, two rows of friction blocks in the cistern and two rows of chute blocks on the impervious floor at the downstream end shall be provided as an additional energy dissipating arrangement. Both friction block and chute blocks are staggered, and the size and position of the blocks are also given. Like friction block, the length must be 2 times DC, width is DC, height must be equal to DC. The distance of the first row from the downstream toe of the crest wall will be about 1.5 DC, and the spacing also between two horizontal rows would be about DC. Where DC is the critical depth, Q² / G² / 1/3. So this is how the blocks are provided. The friction blocks, chute blocks are provided like this. Conveniently staggered. So these are the staggered positions. How they have been staggered? So the location, if you see here and here in between, the second one has come. Similarly here and here in between, you got this chute block. So length, width and height of the chute block usually will be taken to be 1/10 of D2, and the spacing also about 1/10 of D2, and spacing between the blocks in the same row also would be 1/10 of D2, where D2 is the full supply depth in the canal in the downstream portion. One row of chute blocks is provided just at the downstream end of the impervious floor and the other upstream of the above row. We provide the protection works also, like protection work in terms of brick pitching, which is provided very adjacent to the crest on either side, would be provided with the sufficient slopes also. So this is how the protection works, and wings, upstream wings and bed protection and downstream wing wall also would be provided. So upstream wings are kept segmental, so with a radius of about 6 HN, and the downstream bed pitching is kept horizontal for a length of about 6 meters, and which is sloped maybe about 1:10, and downstream wings are kept vertical for a length of about 5 to 8 times the square root of EH2. So this is how upstreaming bed protection and downstream would be provided. So this is all about the Sarda type of fall and their design principles. Okay, so this finishes the design principles of the Sarda type fall, and we have finished the syllabus of water resources engineering 2. I hope I made you comfortable